Good morning, everyone. Welcome again to the Dental Olympics of webinars. Good morning, good evening, and good afternoon from every corner around the world. Today, we're very excited. We have Dr. Alessandro Pozzi all the way from Rome, Italy. And Doctor, welcome.
Thank you, Joseph. Thank you to everyone for staying connected.
We're very excited to know more about you, Doctor, and you're practicing in Rome, Italy. This is where you've always practiced, or you've practiced somewhere else as well?
You know that I have my international center for implant and oral rehabilitation in Rome. So Rome, it's my heritage. It's my real base. But, you know, I'm a globetrotter, so I'm used to travel quite all over for lecturing. And by the way, I have a license to practice also in UK. So let's see what will happen in the future. You know, starting from Rome, and you know, the life is not yet finished. So let's see.
All the historical cities and a lot of heritage. Doctor, I'm going to read your bio very quick, and we'll get to know more about you, and then we can go on with the lecture. Everyone knows about Dr. Pozzi already, but I'm going to let people know more about you with the bio.
Yeah, sure.
Dr. Alessandro Pozzi, entitled as full professor in oral sciences by the Italian Ministry of University and Research and adjunct associate professor at the Goldstein Center for Aesthetic and Implant Dentistry, Augusta University in the United States. He's a guest lecturer in continuing education implant dentistry at UCLA, University of Los Angeles. He has been practicing for more than 20 years, focusing on implant surgery and prosthodontics. Researcher and scientist, widely published, he has been carrying on clinical research on the cutting edges of technologies to integrate the digital workflow in implant dentistry. As a researcher, he received the Judson Hickey Scientific Writing Award as Best Clinical Report of the 2013 by the Journal of the Prosthetic Dentistry. He's the co-author with P.K. Moy and John Boomer of the textbook Fundamentals of Implant Dentistry by Quintessence Publisher, editorial board member of Clinical Implant Dentistry and Related Research Journal, International Journal of Oral Implantology. In the 2020, he received the prestigious fellowship status of the Academy of Osseointegration for his commitment to the fields of osseointegration, both academics and the service to the Academy, active member of the Italian Academy of Aesthetic Dentistry. Since 2011, he has been lecturing in the most prestigious congresses and academics since 2010. He holds international training courses on digital implant dentistry and aesthetics in the International Center of Oral Rehabilitation based in Rome. Doctor, what an honor. It's amazing. It's a researcher, scientist, and an artist. A lot of decades in implant dentistry. Welcome, Dr. Pozzi.
You know, Joseph, it's a matter of being, you know, an hard player in implant and dentistry, and that's it, you know. So it's a matter of passion, of being passionate for try to use digital to elevate the quality of our daily delivery. So it's a matter of that. And, you know, why so many researchers? Because digital is still a baby. So everyone that can collect in a proper way experience, it must submit for a peer review evaluation and try to get it published, because really digital needs evidence still in 2020. So really, I'm in love. I'm a crazy digital guy, but still, you know, the book that I had the honor to publish with Peter Moy and John Bumer, it's a book in which the title is The Fundamentals of Implant Dentistry. So digital, it's blended together with fundamentals. You know, the major mistake is when we think that digital is a way to take a shortcut. Digital is not a shortcut from good practice. Digital is a way to enhance our daily performance. You know, it's a way to meet and address the patient demands. So really, digital is a game changer if we respect and we really keep in our mind the fundamentals. And then suddenly it's a boom, because digital can let us apply and the fundamentals and at the same time deliver high quality results. And don't forget that we provide the services, we provide the service in healthcare. So at the end of the story, our customer, our patient, they want digital, because they are fully aware about the potential of digital in terms of minimal invasiveness, in terms of new prosthetic material that can be more biocompatible, that can be more friendly for the biology around the implant. So really, digital, it's all about modern implant patient.
Yes. So blending the tool with the art and the science itself to get the best.
Yeah, that is the truth. You know, putting together heritage and cutting edge technologies, it's awesome. It's every day I'm wondering about what I can achieve if I really follow up this track and really invite all the people to get an insight in digital and at the same time on the fundamentals of implant dentistry again. So whenever COVID will disappear, I want to invite all our friends from Global Summits to come to Rome for enjoy vacation and why not a few days together. So really welcome.
Dr. Alessandro, how many years have you been doing or blending digital dentistry with your surgeries?
It's the first case was 1999.
Wow.
It was published on my first book. At that time, we were used to work with the anatomic replica of the upper jaw and lower jaw. So from the CBCT scan, from the DICOM file of the CBCT scan, there were a physical workflow to produce prototypes coming from DICOM, from CBCT. It was really the pristine digital workflow. So at that time, from the CBCT, from the medical CT in particular, we were able to produce and fabricate a replica of the anatomy of the upper and lower jaw. And this was amazing, particularly for the major atrophy, to try to connect the prosthetic part with the surgical part. So at that time, we mount the digital replica on the physical articulator, like a model. And then we start planning on the physical articulator using this replica of the bone, of the upper jaw, of the lower jaw, and try to create the link between the bone and the prost. So the soft tissue that at that time was reproduced in silicon and the prosthetic contour. So really, it was very challenging at that time because there were no a real link. Now with the modern digital workflow, we have a true link connecting the surgical part with the prosthetic part. And that is unbelievable to look for complication in advance. Absolutely. Instead of treating complication.
Have you seen a lot of advancement, massive paradigm shift in the technology recently? From 15 years ago?
Yeah, it's the major problem that company and industry are moving so fast that we don't have time to validate all what happened. So sometimes, we find in the market new devices, new software that unfortunately, we didn't have time still to validate from the clinical perspective, so in the patient mouth. So the major problem today is being stuck to a clinically proven, digital workflow. Because even if the software looks similar, the algorithms of the software, they don't look at all similar. So what is behind the software, we don't see. We just see a beautiful layout in front of our screen, in which, you know, bones of tissue and implant, they are blended together. But, you know, at the end of the story, we need to look for the final outcome in the patient mouth. And really, we are still far from click on a button and, you know, get it done in the patient mouth. And maybe this is, we are lucky for that, you know, because the day that the computer will manage all the aspect of the implant treatment, for sure, we'll be fired.
We don't want that.
I don't want that, you know. I want still to make money treating my patient and still enjoy my patient and their family. So, you know, I guess that robotic surgery is still far from being an active treatment. It's still semi-active, so there is still room for us. So maybe, hopefully, for the next two generations, we can still rule the game.
Things that are handmade are more expensive.
It's a more expensive for sure, but you know that most of the money that we waste every day is for compensate mistakes, particularly in implant dentistry, you know? And don't forget that implant success doesn't last up to the delivery of the prosthesis, but implant success is a matter of time. So even if sometimes digital seems more expensive, after 5, 10, 15 years of digital, you know, I look behind and I'm happy for that investment, for sure.
Yes. The analysis and everything is just more blended. Doctor, it's a pleasure to have you today. We're ready to start the presentation if you would like to.
Yeah,
and
sure.
Then we're going to have some questions at the end of the lecture, and the public is more than welcome just to start posting their questions as we go.
Perfect. So hope that you have fun, okay?
We will.
Okay, so let me tell you why I'm so in love with digital. So digital is the best way to coordinate function, biology, and aesthetics. So digital, 10 years ago, was only drilling through a template. Today, digital is the best way to better understanding what we learn on the book, in which we really learn about the fundamentals of implant dentistry. So digital is the best way to visualize in advance what we want to deliver. This is a beautiful picture in which we have an amazing interface, in which we have an amazing soft tissue interface and an amazing bone tissue interface. And these two factors work together to guarantee the success in the long run. Moreover, what I learned from digital, we don't need anymore several implants, lots of implants. We don't have a magic number to rehabilitate all the upper jaw or all the mandibles. What I learned from digital, that instead of placing 8 implants, for example, we prefer to place 4 to 6 in the upper jaw, in order to leave more space between the implants. This is an incredible concept, because if we want to reconfigurate, if we want to reshape the bone and the soft tissue interface, we want the biology of the bone and the biology of the soft tissue that will remain between the implants. I don't want the titanium material. I don't want implant one close to the other, but I prefer to position a less number of implant. I prefer to position longer implant that will engage high cortical structure. And this is because stability and success, it's not a matter of number. This is completely proven, 15 years of follow-up in the mandible, 10 years in the upper jaw. So we need to understand that. We need to understand that we want to visualize in advance the ideal implant position according with the prosthetic contour. And this prosthetic contour can be digitally visualized, or in other case, for the most complex case, we still need a physical object like a sort of a static guide that we position into the mouth after the phonetic try-in, after validating the occlusion, and then we can visualize this aesthetic and functional guidance into the software in order to better understanding the tooth display from the lip line, the lip support. With digital, we cannot push the lip forward. With the physical guidance, we can provide the good support for this case in which we have a massive atrophy. And moreover, we can visualize the interplay between the soft tissue, the prosthetic contour, and the bone. Because what I learned from so many years of digital delivery is that, you know, it's not anymore a golden rule to position the implant at the bony level. We don't want to position the implant necessarily at the crestal level, but sometimes we get advantage from the modern prosthetic connection, particularly the conical connection. We get advantage from the multi-unit that will seal the connection, and we position the implant deeper into the bone in order to being able to emerge and flare with a nice prosthetic contour from the implant platform or from the multi-unit platform up to the prosthetic contour that we validate into the patient mouth, or the prosthetic contour that we digitally design. So there are no golden rules today in the modern implant dentistry. There is a personalized approach. This is a beautiful full arch with 10 years of integration into the soft tissue. So no pink interface, no cutting bone, unless we really need to leverage the bone surface. Whenever we can, we keep the bone and we invest in digital to precise positioning the implant. So we really invest so many time in conducting really serious and well-designed clinical researches. We presented this randomized clinical trial at the Academy of OS Integration in 2016 in San Francisco. And thereafter, we published this randomized clinical trial in the International Journal of Oral Implantology. And today, after, you know, it was 2015 when it was published, today we really can draw a line, because when we work with digital, for sure we can increase the survival rates of our implant, particularly when we position the implant in a fresh alveolar socket or when we load immediately the implant. Moreover, when we work with a minimal invasive surgical approach, we can experience a better bone resorption trend. So it means that the bone resorption pattern will be better in patients treated with a guided approach instead of patient treated open flap and free end. Moreover, the complication rate can drop. And this is why I love digital. This is why sometimes I spend 1 hour planning a complex case, because I want to look in advance for complication instead of treating complication in the patient mouth. And in 2020, for me, it doesn't make sense anymore to position an implant freehand. It's a strong statement, I know, but that is the truth in my practice. So really, I split my implant surgery activities between static template guided surgery, in which we use a 3D printed template to drill through and to transfer the implant position from the software in the patient mouth. But at the same time, I have quite 5 years of experience with dynamic navigation, and that for me is the real future. That is the way to... That is the way to deliver implant today in my practice, because I can get the advantages of working freehand, and at the same time, my hand are fully guided by my eye, my brain, that are watching at the screen, and this amazing machine track in real time the patient movement and match the real patient that is seated on the chair with the virtual patient that is in the screen. So I have the advantages of a full control of the implant drilling, because sometimes when we drill with the template, we are not confident that we are drilling in the pre-planned position. And this is because the template, unfortunately, mask the surgical field, hide the surgical field, unfortunately represent and can hamper the soft tissue management. With a dynamic navigation, I don't have any physical guidance. I have a virtual guidance that is connected with my brain, with my eye, and with my hand. And this allows to use a guidance like the virtual guidance, the navigation guidance, in quite all the scenario. We just started a few months ago to treat a zygoma case with the assistance of the dynamic navigation. So why we should invest in digital technology? Because my decision making must be based on a personalized dentistry. Personalized dentistry is the tailoring of the dental treatment. I don't want to draw a line. I don't want to tell you that all my patients are treated with the All-on-4, All-on-6. I want to tailor-made my decision-making according with the aesthetic demands, face rejuvenation, the functional demands, how many implants, in which position. We'll be able to support a fixed prosthesis or a removable implant-supported prosthesis. This is what I mean for personalized implant dentistry, and that's why I love digital. Because a case like that, you know, if we look at the lateral projection of the skull, or if we look at the conventional orthopantomograph, we are confused, because where is the bone? How I can place the bone? This is a zygoma case. Maybe I need to augment the sinus. That is not the truth. We cannot take any decision based on a bidimensional assessment of the patient anatomy. It's an incredible case. I treat this case more than 12 years ago. So the upper jaw and the upper and lower jaw skeletal relationship. And here we go. This is the 3D rendering of the maxilla. So where is it, the bone? Where I can place the bone? Do I have the zygoma solution be the same solution available for this patient? Can be less invasive. There are several medical compromised patients that can get benefit from a guided surgery and prosthetic. I want to be minimally invasive, because in Italy we have more and more patients that are going through the third dentition. The life expectancy is growing. And we need to expect to be as less invasive as possible because we are treating more and more patients that are medical compromised. So it's a major atrophy, but we were able to position 2 implants in the front, 4 implants in the premolar zone, and 2 implants in the pterygoid plate. And we positioned the implant in the pterygoid plate with a flapless approach because the keratinized tissue is there. And we positioned the remaining 6 implants with a mini flap. And this is the outcome. And again, please don't be confused by the orthopantomograph, because I show you that the implant were properly positioned in the proper position that will allow to support the prosthesis and at the same time to maintain the biology. The implant in this, the 6 anterior implant are not all connected like we can see in this orthopantomograph. So the bidimensional assessment is a big issue for meeting the patient demands. We cannot take any decision based on that. And it's amazing, but it's a major atrophy, but where is it the pink? Where is it the pink prosthetic interface? We published in 2012 this the first manuscript that clinically validate the use of zirconia material as a cold framework in which on which at that time we bond the lithium disilicate crown. So it's about 8 years ago. Even this is a completely game changer. We don't use for this patient any pink support simply because we don't need that. Even if it's a major atrophy, we don't need to deliver pink interface for all the patients without teeth. And this is because we can really validate the prosthetic needs of the patient working with digital. So that was the pre-op. This is the upper jaw. And these tiny fragment of porcelain, they were used to recover and restore the function in the lower jaw in order to deliver the cuspid guidance. So again, do we really need the pink for all the atrophic case? The lip is fully supported. This is 1 year. 3 year follow-up, 5 years, 7 years, 10. The 5 year outcome, the 11 year clinical outcome. And what we experience is a recession of the soft tissue in this area of the mouth that can be easily fixed with the soft tissue grafting in case the patient needs. But the patient is still attending the office, all the recall appointments. So she really doesn't need that. So in most of the cases, we can achieve the proper face rejuvenation, restoring the vertical dimension of the patient and restoring the proper skeletal relationship of the upper and lower jaw in the three planes of the face, of the facial aesthetics. And let me show you the outcome, because you know, this is the patient on the left side at beginning of his treatment. On the right side, it's 11 years follow-up. She went through 2 strokes, but she's still enjoying his life and she's still enjoying his beautiful smile. So that's why we decide to elaborate and to investigate a technique that could allow all the clinician, all the dental teams to put all the information together before delivering the implant. This technique is amazing, really was published in 2018 after a long review process in the Journal of Prosthodontic Research. And this technique, the name is a smiling scan. After 5 years, we scan more than 700 patients. And what we achieve in just one DICOM file, we can import into the software the face anatomy, the lip frame, the lip contour, and the transition zone, just inviting the patient to keep a broad smile like that for 6 to 8 seconds. That is the effective scanning time of the modern Conbeam CT devices. And moreover, with the modern implant software, this is the DTX software, what we did, we create a digital workflow in which, first of all, I want to orient the digital patient with the static plane that we take as a reference, properly aligned with the horizontal plane. Thereafter, we can easily trim the anatomy, the intraoral anatomy that we don't need and we don't want render from the CBCT. So we are just trimming along the border of the lip. And then in a click, we can visualize the IO scanning. So we don't need cumbersome, complicated technology and workflow for taking our decision. We don't need expensive face scanner to import the facial characteristic in the patient mouth, in the implant software. We just need the DICOM data. We just need the CBCT assessment. And we have all the information, including the skin, that can be easily rendered by the modern implant software. And now what we can achieve? We can achieve a ideal tooth design that can be done digitally, or we can perform a WhatsApp, and thereafter we can scan the WhatsApp and overlay the WhatsApp on the top of the CBCT. So this idea is smart, because digital doesn't mean that we need to shut down the brain. Digital means optimize the information that we achieve from the 3D assessment of the CBCT. And it's not yet finished. You see that now I'm in the prosthetic software, and all the information of the patient comes from the same DICOM set. So from the DICOM data, I can achieve the bone, or I can achieve the skin. It's according to what we are giving as a reference to the software. What is it, the ISO value, that the software will consider to render the patient anatomy? And you see that the bone and the skin comes from the same DICOM dataset. So in a click, using anatomic landmark, we can fuse bone skin in the prosthetic software. So again, we don't need the several mesh coming from face scanner, coming from complicated workflow, coming from overlaying a bidimensional photography of the face on the top of the 3D anatomy. We already have all the information in the CBCT, and the Smiler scan technique can allow us to put the prosthetic and surgical needs together. Because now it's easy for me to design the proper prosthetic contour. But it's not finished yet, because I can also visualize in the prosthetic software the soft tissue contour. So I can better understanding what will be the interplay between the bone and the soft tissue. I can better understanding if the patient really needs a pink interface to support the leap. And we can investigate what will be the relationship at the implant level and pontic level between the bone, the soft tissue, and the prosthetic contour. And this is another amazing new trend of digital, in which we use digital to really assess the interplay and to really assess the biology of the interface of the bone and the soft tissue underneath the pontic and all around the implant. Even this technique has been recently published on the Journal of Prosthodontic Research and at the EAO meeting, virtual meeting that will be held this year, I'm going to present this type of results. So at this time point, after planning the ideal implant number, then for me, it's pure fun, because you see that I'm watching at the screen. In the screen, I'm watching at the virtual patient, and the virtual patient is consistently track with the real patient that is sitting on the chair. So I can place a straight implant or an angulated implant just following the blue track, the blue trajectory, and following this target. I want to stay in the middle of the target. And moreover, what I can tell you is that we can also plan in advance a prosthesis that can be easily delivered in the patient mouth through the navigation technology. And this is one of the latest concepts. You see, it's a prosthesis without pink, and you can appreciate this pin, and this pin will go through the bone. So with the navigation technology, we can prepare the implant site, and we can navigate the implant into the implant site. At the same time, we can prepare the recipient site for this pin that will allow to realign the prosthesis on the top of the implant into the aesthetic and functional pre-planned position. I don't want to spend too much time in the surgical theater grinding the tooth surface or the provisional, because this, the aesthetic plane is canted or the teeth are too forward or too lingual inclined. And this concept was developed with my dear friend Lars Hansson, and it was submitted for publication. So one of the major topic today for my aesthetic delivery is using more and more the prosthesis as a prosthetic scaffold, and particularly the digital prosthesis, because I really want to visualize in advance if I can deliver such a scallop interface. And the best way to deliver such a scallop interface is planning in advance how much deep I must go with the implant, how much deep I must go with the pontic, how much bone I have to remove for each pontic site, how much soft tissue I must to implement or enhance. And at this time point, what is important is collecting the implant coordinates in the proper way. So digital is not only guided surgery or navigation, it's also guided prosthesis. And this is the latest trend in my clinical research. This is stereophotogrammetry We are using stereophotogrammetry for recording the implant coordinate. And this is what we can achieve with this prototype. Usually for the static case, we are used to fabricate a second set of provisional that will be duplicated into the final zirconia prosthesis. And this prototype is completely digitally fabricated, included the Pontic interface. You see that I'm going to insert through the soft tissue, no blanching, no excessive pressure. And again, minor adjustment of the occlusion. So why I love that? Because when you work on digital, we must understand that. We must use digital when it works. Unfortunately, we already published a randomized in vitro clinical trial, try to investigate the intraoral scanning for full arch impression. And the results are not satisfactory in terms of consistency, in terms of consistent accuracy. Because even if the modern intraoral optical scanner can be accurate, the major problem are the extreme values. So it means that maybe we are scanning four implants and two out of four are completely accurate, and the other two or just one, the deviation are too far from being accepted, too far from delivering on the top of an implant something that is completely passive. So what we are currently doing, we are using the stereophotogrammetry for recording the coordinates of the implant. Then I'm using the ARIO scanning for recording the scalloping of the soft tissue. And then we put together the two information. So the zirconia framework is produced onto the stereophotogrammetry file, and we print out a model that is not the real master cast. It's only a working cast in case the dental technician wants a physical model to enhance the fabrication of the final porcelain on the top of the zirconia or the final detailing of the occlusion in case of monolithic zirconia. So before producing the zirconia framework, we can 3D printed or 3D mill a prototype, or that can be a second set of provisional, or we can use as a prototype this very not expensive plastic resin. We put this resin into the mouth, we check the occlusion, we adjust the resin, and then we scan it back and we merge onto the real master cast that is the master cast with the coordinates coming from the stereophotogrammetry. And this is the final restoration, is a translucent zirconia with the zirconia surface, occlusal surface at the cantilever level, at the second premolar level, and at the first premolar level, and a cut back in the front that will be covered by porcelain, by lithium disilicate three-quarter crowns in order to achieve the details of the aesthetics that this patient expected so far. Moreover, what I want to tell you that sometimes digital is lacking. So particularly if you love to work with monolithic translucent zirconia, I strongly invite you to perform this prototype try-in. In this case, we use also to apply a specific wax on the top of the zirconia raw file after sintering in order to customize as a tailor the incisal edge and provide to the dental technician the final shape functionally and adjusted incisal edge and the final morphology of the anterior teeth. And you see that once again, as we reported in 2013, we blended together the solid zirconia and we used zirconia as a solid framework, and then the static part is delivered with lithium disilicate veneer or lithium disilicate three-quarter crown. And again, please focus the attention on the interface, because this is my major concern. Really, this type of interface, it's something that is unbelievable. It's really unbelievable, because there is no bleeding, there is no plaque accumulation, there is a tight adherence between the zirconia surface and the soft tissue interface. And please focus on the bone interface. For the anterior teeth, we use a root shield technique in order to maintain the convexity, the buccal convexity of the anterior teeth. And please focus on the scalloping of the bone, because the soft tissue mirrors the bone. If the soft tissue is flat, if the bone is flat, the soft tissue is flat. If the bone is scalloped with the proper soft tissue thickness, such a scallop interface will last over time. And the two lateral projection of the skull, in which you can see that we restore the vertical dimension, the proper centric relation. And this start with the smiling scan technique. So the smiling scan technique really is an amazing technique in which we validate in advance what we are delivering at the end of the treatment. Let me conclude with the final trend in navigation technology, because this is really incredible. Let me show you that. For about 5 years, we were used to treat our cases, major atrophic cases, positioning some tiny screw into the bone. What we are experiencing right now is a completely different technique. Completely different technique. What does it mean? It means that we don't need any more any type of device in the patient mouth before scanning the patient. We don't need any more. We don't need any type of little screw into the bone before the CBCT. We don't need any type of smart clip before scanning the patient. And this is a way to simplify the first step of the implant treatment, because we can directly scan the patient. And this is possible thanks to this amazing algorithm that the name is XMark algorithm, that allow to match the real patient with the virtual patient without any type of reference in the patient mouth. Let me better explain. So we just perform our CBCT scan. Then we are going to mark this four red dot, four green dot, and four pink dots. And this rainbow area will appear on the top of the bone or on the top of the remaining dentition. We are just telling to the software what will be the area of the mouth that we consider trustable to match the real patient with the virtual patient. So this beautiful rainbow can be adjusted, because for the zygoma case, for example, I'm going to mark as a rainbow area to refine the virtual matching between virtual patient and real patient. I'm going to extend this area up to the zygoma bone, because a zygoma is a solid bone to be used for matching the real patient with the virtual patient. And this can be done in the upper and lower jaw, no matter of jaw. So it can really done in a predictable way. So the first step is marking three virtual anatomic landmark, and these three landmark can be represented by a tooth or can be represented by the bone. Then thereafter, after marking in the virtual patient this 3 point, we are going to mark this 3 point in the real patient. And boom, the real patient and the virtual patient are blended together and ready for the surgery. If you are not satisfied and if you want to challenge the system, why not? You can go through a refinement and you can literally draw on the top of the bone. So what we are doing right now with the specific probe, I'm drawing, I'm painting the bone surface, I'm just touching with the tip of this probe the bone surface or the tooth surface. And the AI, the artificial intelligence of the software of the algorithm, is learning from our touching where is the bone, where is the CBCT anatomy that the algorithm is blending with the real anatomy. And this extend the use and the clinical application of the dynamic navigation to case like that, which we don't have any type of reference that can be trustable in the patient mouth. Because we have bridge, and the bridge create strict artifacts, because the lower teeth are completely destroyed. So we start working, putting together dynamic navigation model algorithm with the smiling scan technique, with elevating the centric relation and the vertical dimension of the patient virtually into the software, and before of that, in the clinical mouth of the patient, in order to record the CBCT with the proper centric relation, with the proper skeletal relationship between the upper and the lower jaw. And at this time point, it's a really pure fun. The lower was restored with the pink assisted prosthesis. The upper was restored with a pink free prosthesis. And what it's really amazing that we can also trim the bone using the navigation technology and cutting exactly the amount of bone that we need according with the length of this pink interface in order to leave at least 3 millimeters of soft tissue in between the bone and the pink prosthesis, pink interface. The upper jaw was completely pink free, and we did the same. We cut the bone off, but only on the right side in order to deliver a prosthetic plane that is completely leveraged, and in order to deliver once again this beautiful DynaV prosthesis. You see that we cut the bone off on the right side, only on the right side, where the teeth and the bone were super erupted. While in the lower jaw, we cut more horizontally in order to create the same plane between the posterior quadrants and the anterior part of the mandible. The maturation of the soft tissue, beautiful scallop soft tissue, the maturation is still ongoing. But you can appreciate the advantages and how technology can really be a game changer for the quality of life of this patient. in just one appointment. 3 minutes and I conclude. This is the final restoration, the upper and the lower jaw. We have monolithic zirconia in the posterior quadrants while we use lithium disilicate in the anterior zone. All the prostheses were delivered at the implant unit, at the implant abutment level, or at the multi-unit level. We don't have time to comment on that, but this is our choice when we come up to zirconia for full arch, and this is what we publish so far, and we have recently submitted the 10 years follow-up with this cross-arch restoration. The lateral view, the final orthopantomograph, and the final patient smile. And really, this is what I want to achieve in my daily practice. It's not only a matter of smile, it's a matter of face rejuvenation. So we need to understand that, you know, teeth are not only a prosthesis. Teeth is the way to keep the upper and the lower jaw, the mid part of the face and the lower part at the proper distance in order to give the proper biology space, not only to the gums, but also to the skin. And this is what you can achieve with the proper soft tissue and with the proper functional and aesthetic rehabilitation. With this, I want to thank all of you for your attention. And I'm ready for the Q&A session, for the question and answer. And I hope that you enjoy and you have fun with this lecture. Thank you.
Dr. Posey, it's a beautiful work. Unbelievable. I have a few questions for you. Do you ever add some microsurgical techniques for the dental papilla to be able to be enhanced more during the scalping? Like adding some of the Palaszczuk technique or anything like that in that sense, or you don't really most of the time need it?
It's a good question. When you take the teeth out, we have a very biologically favorable interface. We have a wound, we have an open wound, and the open wound is full of regenerative potential. So let me tell you that if we want to increase the quality of the keratinized tissue, because maybe we cut the bone off, maybe we don't have enough keratinized tissue, we need autogenous soft tissue. If we want to increase the volume of the soft tissue, because the histology is already there, so the tissue is already keratinized, then we can use a soft tissue substitute. That's why to achieve this nicely shaped papilla, I'm used to use xenogenic material to augment the volume, and the autogenous soft tissue, usually harvested from the tuberosity, for increase the quality and the histological characteristic of the soft tissue. So both techniques are fine. Usually I don't perform micro, tiny surgical technique because in this step, the soft tissue is very fragile. So during the delivery of the second set of provisional, at that time, if you need, you can perform microsurgery. So Palaszczuk technique is still very updated. But any type of pedicle perform with a healthy and sound healthy keratinized soft tissue, the outcome is more predictable. So what I can tell you is that if you need to increase maybe the papilla length or the papilla thickness, that is the time, not the time of the implant placement, but when you deliver the second step, or at least after 2-3 months from the implant positioning.
So how often, if the patient, for example, came to you with a denture already, and you're planning a full arch prosthetic for him. Will you be able, or how often will you be able to do it without using any pink porcelain or any pink acrylic?
That is a very good question, you know, because the first patient that I show you, the old lady, he came in, he knocked the door of the office with a full denture. And so I was really wondered, but she really didn't need the pink after restoring the proper vertical dimension. So what I want to tell you is that when the patient arrived with the denture, first of all, put the denture of the patient and threw the denture into the bin.
Scan it.
You know? Because in most of the cases, this denture doesn't provide any information. So of course I'm joking, don't put in the bin, but use the current denture of the patient as a starting point, duplicate the denture, and start to increase the vertical dimension. So when we have patients that have been wearing denture for years, we really need to use a training denture. So in the book, there is a chapter on training denture. Training denture means that we need to add resin to the current denture of the patient. Maybe with composite, we can increase the incisal edge. So then the patient start to use this training denture, that is the current denture modified. And when you and the patient are satisfied about the phonetics, the aesthetics, the lip support, then you take decision. And you'll be wondered that there are several patients in which they didn't experience a centric resorption of the upper jaw. So there are lots of patients with vertical resorption, but not a sagittal resorption of the upper of the anterior maxilla. This patient can be treated without pink easily, even if there is no bond, or maybe you put 10 millimeter implant, but still can be treated without pink. And trust me, it's much worse, a long and high pink interface than the scallop for the hygienic maintenance.
It's much better, you're saying?
It's much better scallop than a very high and long pink interface.
Yep, absolutely. And there's more vascularity around the tissues as well.
More vascularity, more success for the implant, more biology.
Yes. And the patient is always happier as well. What's your thoughts about something like the Weld One and things that you weld the prosthetic, like with Dr. Marco DeGini, for example?
Yeah, Marco, it's a great guy. You know, it's a pleasure. Every time that I met him all around the world, we always have fun together. So Marco, hello. So Weld One technique, it's a way to splinting the implant. So usually, just in the last case, I didn't splint the implant because I'm trying to use for immediate loading new CAD-CAM material that have a flexural strength higher than the conventional PMMA. But usually, I always use a metal framework in the provisional, particularly when you deliver prosthesis without pink. So the Weld One technique, it's very interesting because it can splint the implant with the rigid framework. So it's interesting, but for sure we need a dental technician close by the office. We need a dental technician that will quickly produce such technology, and we need another device. Let's try to think out of the box. What does it mean? Stereophotogrammetry, for example. Now there is just one device that it's very accurate. But in the future, there will be this technique will spread out, and for sure the price will go down. Why I'm telling you that? Because when I finish my surgery, I always ask the patient, do you want to get the immediate prosthesis today or the day after or tomorrow? Why I'm telling you that? Because sometimes our patient, regardless if they are sedated or not, they are tired after the surgery. So they can easily prefer to go at home and maybe check in the office the day after or after 2 days, and then you can screw in the prosthesis. Why I'm telling you that? Because we need to think as a patient. Patient want everything done in seconds. This is not possible for complex case. So sometimes when you cut the bone, when you manipulate the soft tissue, when you place the implant, when you take the teeth out, the patient is exhausted. So now what we are doing? We are still doing immediate function, but we take the impression with the stereophotogrammetry, and then we deliver the prosthesis the day after. And in that case, we mill an aluminium frame, and the prosthesis is wrapped all around this aluminium frame. So the digital workflow is so quick that taking the impression intraoperative, it's becoming a matter of 10 seconds.
Yes.
So the concept, both are good, Joseph. What is important that we deliver whenever we can, splinting immediate function, okay? So we splint the implant.
What's your thoughts about when it comes to guided surgery, guiding the handpiece rather than guiding the drill itself, in comparison to the other technique that you like with the camera guiding your handpiece? What's the pros and cons in your opinion about each one?
Guided surgery is, in my hands, as 15 years of experience. So I experienced the failures. That's why today I love the navigation, because template for atrophic case, it's challenging, because for example, in the upper jaw, in most of the case, we have a massive amount of soft tissue, and the template can slide on the top of the soft tissue when you secure with the anchor pin. Yes. In fact, in the original protocol, you should position the template in the same position that the denture, the patient wear the denture during the CBCT, using a silicone index. It's usually, you know, in most of the cases, I don't see people using this silicone index. And this is a big mistake, because if the prosthesis, if the template is sliding forward when you secure with the anchor pin, you don't appreciate, you don't get any alarm from that. So it means that when you treat an atrophic upper jaw, the canting of the template or the sliding back and forward of the template can happen, is one of the major mistakes. So template is absolutely trustable, but when you have a stiff support, for example, three teeth, two in the back, one in the front, it's super. So don't take all the teeth out. Keep three teeth like a tripod, and you put the template on the top, because these three teeth will contribute to increase the accuracy. So this is a limitation of the template. Template for partial, it's amazing, but partial in the posterior quadrants, it's unrealistic because of the mouth opening. You know, even if you use a short drill, it's very difficult to go through the template in the posterior quadrants. Very difficult. So with navigation, you can navigate wherever you want. We are navigating with the zygoma.
Adjusted, yeah.
So, and still, I can't see, you know, but this is because look at my hair. They are very white, you know, and I'm losing the hair.
I'm here too.
It means that, you know, too many failure to take risk with the patient. You know, I want to be safe, use template when is safe. So when I have a few teeth in the mouth or a full arch, but with a few soft tissue.
Yeah. When you're doing the denture to condition the tissues and adjust and reprogram the muscles, and making sure that everything with the phonetics and the architecture of the occlusion and everything is as good as it can be. How often or how long do you work on that usually? A month, three months. Beautiful lecture, beautiful information. What's your thoughts on the future when you lay back and just think how this is gonna be evolving in the next few years? What are your expectations for all this? How digital dentistry is going to be mimicking and blending in with all the kind of surgeries that we're doing recently. What do you think in the next 5-10 years is going to be happening?
I would love to know, you know, I'm so wondering, you know, when I started more than 15 years ago, I was considered like crazy, you know. Now I still have a crazy hair. But you know, more and more people today are working with digital. So what I want, it's really to make digital more affordable. So that's why I show you, for example, the smiley scan technique, because we don't need a face scanner, you know, even if sometimes you can scan with the iPhone, but then the information coming from the iPhone must be absolutely and in the best accurate way blended on the top of the bone, because otherwise we are inventing the anatomy. So what I'm dreaming is a more simple and comprehensive digital workflow, more simple and comprehensive and patient friendly. This will happen for sure. We don't need the 10 years. So I assume that even with the COVID-19, you know, industry now are a little bit stuck, you know, but we need to think in this period, get advantage from COVID, from this strategy, thinking positive, and try to think how we can improve our practice. It's like a sabbatic year, you know?
Yes. We have more time and more room to think how to plan more. So the surgery is shorter and less. And I think in the future, there's going to be a lot of software that is just blending everything a little bit more easy. Dr. Alessandro, it's a beautiful lecture. It's a beautiful work and very intelligent blending of everything. I'm just waiting if anyone have more questions for Dr. Posey, please let me know and start posting your questions here. Everyone is saying hi, and they love it very much from all the comments that I'm reading.
Thank you. Thank you to all of you.
Any more questions? I think you answered them all, Doctor. As we're going to be sharing these lectures, there's going to be a lot of people asking some questions. So we'll be happy if you can reply to some of them. Dr. Posey, we're looking forward to hopefully seeing you soon after the COVID in one of our congresses. And it's an honor, and we'll keep following your beautiful work all the time.
thank you for your invitation. It was a pleasure to be in contact, and really hopefully I can meet you in person as soon as I can. Sure. You're very welcome to Rome, very welcome.
We will be coming, all of us.
Enjoy your family.
You too, doctor. Thank you, Dr. Posey.
Bye-bye.
Pleasure.
Bye-bye.